الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. The lecture which I desire to deliver today will focus about the events that are taking place presently in the Holy Land of Baytul Muqaddas. However, the points that I will mention, some of it are such that it could be correct, it could be incorrect. And with the passing of time, every person will then see how close it was to the truth. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has given us the Quran, which is tibyan li kulli shay, which explains every matter, but every single matter is not going to be found exactly as we want it in the Quran. There will be a lot of things that show indication towards something, and when that thing finally happens, man looks at the verse of the Quran and says it was there right at the beginning. So looking into the Quran to find what is happening presently in Baytul Muqaddas, certain ulama have taken this road. It might be a correct road, it might be incorrect. I will mention their view, and I will thereafter open a chapter. Most of us are students. As we study, and as we see things unfolding in front of our eyes, then we can then judge whether the view that those ulama had taken was correct, whether what they said was right. And if it was right, it will put us in a stance of preparation, and we will know what is then going to unfold before our eyes. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala revealed about the Jews in Baytul Muqaddas. They were the chosen people. They were the progeny of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. They were known as the Bani Israel. They were given Baytul Muqaddas as their land because they were those people in the world who were found obedient to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And they were always promised that if you have to be disobedient, then this land will be taken away from you. So Surah Bani Israel, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions that once we gave it to them, and for a long period of time they had it, until they began changing the scriptures. They wanted to make riba permissible. They wanted to make halal haram, haram halal. And when the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam came and warned them, they became angry. And they took out their anger on the Anbiya to such an extent that they murdered many of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. So a warning was been given to them that if I do not stop, the entire masjid will be taken away, and it happened. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala sent a king from Babylon. He destroyed the entire masjid, and all the Bani Israel who were left alive were taken as prisoner. And they remained in exile for a very long period of time, but they were all together in one place. Thereafter they made tawbah. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala after many years gave them the chance, and another king came, took them out of the predicament, and they were able to return back to the Holy Land. So once they were kicked out and they were brought back. Thereafter again they went back to their old ways, to such an extent that when Nabi Yahya alayhi salatu wasalam, his father Zakariya alayhi salatu wasalam, warned them, then they murdered those great Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam in the Mubarak precincts of the masjid itself. And they intended then to murder Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala thereafter lifted him up, and they felt that they had murdered him. Before Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was lifted, he warned them that for what you have done now and the blood you have spilt, especially of Yahya alayhi salam, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is going to send such an enemy on you that from the bottom of your masjid they will uproot everything. فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعَدُ الْآخِرَةِ وَلِيُتَبِّرُوا مَا عَلَوْ تَتْبِيرًا. Every single thing. When that army came, they really felt under the masjid there's gold buried. So they made the effort to even take out the bricks from under, just to look where is that gold. And the Bani Israel then were not sent to one place and left, but they were scattered throughout the world, so that the chance of them ever returning would look practically impossible. After this year, the Bani Israel scattered in the world. Many of them reached Medina Munawwara, because they saw there the signs that the final messenger is coming. Asa Rabbukum ay yarhamakum. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala promised that there is a chance that Allah Pak will have mercy on you one more time. And that time will be when the last messenger will come. If you will bring iman on him, then within a very short space of time, his Khalifa Umar radiallahu an will conquer the entire land of Palestine. And every Jew will then get the chance to go back to his Mubarak land. Asa Rabbukum ay yarhamakum. The chance of your Lord forgiving you is very, very close. Nabi Pak alayhi salatu wasalam came to Medina Munawwara, and for 17 months he faced Baytul Muqaddas to show, I am the Nabi of this masjid, to invite the Jews that I am that final messenger. Hazrat Safiya radiallahu anha says she was a small girl. Her uncle had a lot of love for her. Whenever he would enter the house, he would grab her, hold her. One day when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam reached the outskirts of Medina Munawwara, Kufa, in Quba, and all the Jews went to go and see him. Who is he? Is he the last messenger? When they came back, she says, my uncle walked past me. He did not even look at me. I realized something was wrong. Hazrat Safiya radiallahu anha became the wife of Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wasallam later on. So she said, I heard my uncle and my father speaking. My father said to my uncle, what do you think? Is it him? My uncle opened up the holy scriptures and said, wallah, it is him. So my father said, what are we going to do? My uncle said, till the day I die, I will continue opposing him and fighting against him. I will never accept him. They had that racism in them. They believed that the Arabs from the progeny of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam were like donkeys, were like animals. They were the filth of the earth. And now that person who they believed to be the filth of the earth, to now put their head down and say that this is the main messenger of Allah, was too hard for them. So despite knowing that he is the last ruler, that racism in them never allowed them to accept. So the chance of them then returning to Baytul Muqaddas was now zero. Umar radiallahu anhu thereafter, وَإِنْ عُدْتُمْ عُدْنَا, there is a chance that we will show our mercy on you by sending the last messenger. وَإِنْ عُدْتُمْ, and if you return to your stubbornness again, and if you return to your ways of plotting to kill the messenger of Allah, then عُدْنَا, then we will return with our adab and punishment. Mufassirin explain what punishment was then given to them. The Jews of Medina Munawwara were then exiled. Many of them were killed. And from that time onwards, they never got the chance to get a land of their own. They remained all over the world in bits and pieces, searching for someone to look after them, always being the hated of the group, never finding any political power. So that is what Quran has mentioned regarding the Bani Israel. Thereafter, a time in history came where man saw suddenly things changing. And after 2,000 years of being exiled from Baytul Muqaddas, the Jews start coming back to Baytul Muqaddas. From a Quranic point of view, it was as though they will never come back. They were given the last chance. They left it. The chance now to come back is gone. But on the view of وَإِنْ عُدْتُمْ عُدْنَا, that if you all go back to your ways of disobedience, we will come back with a punishment. Ulama have mentioned that they're coming back to Baytul Muqaddas now. It is not for that, so that they can take that land which was their original inheritance, and so that they can get that blessed Mubarak land because of their obedience. But it is وَإِنْ عُدْتُمْ عُدْنَا, that if you all return to your disobedience, we will return to our punishment. And they are all now coming there for one severe punishment. So if we look in the Quran, where is this mentioned, we will find, and perhaps this is the meaning of this verse, which is not very clear. وَحَرَامٌ عَلَىٰ قَرِيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا أَنَّهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ, that village or that nation which we have destroyed. Now ulama, they do not know who this nation is. Mufassirin have not mentioned. But when the Jews started moving towards Baytul Muqaddas after 2,000 years of being exiled, many ulama said that this qariya refers to Baytul Muqaddas itself. So it is haram on that city that we have destroyed. أَنَّهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ, that they will never ever return back to Baytul Muqaddas. حَتَّى إِذَا فُتِحَتْ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ, until the opening up of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ حَدَبِ يَنْسِلُونَ, and when Ya'juj Ma'juj gets that strength of theirs which they did not have before, when they reach the pinnacle of their power, that they will fall on the world from every side and corner. As I said from the beginning, this is a possible tarjuma. It is not a definite tarjuma. Mufassirin have not made it. It is only after the Jews started coming back to Baytul Muqaddas that recent ulama, some of them, have said this. If it is true, the first question then will come, who is the Ya'juj Ma'juj? So many of us have it in our mind that Dhul-Qarnayn, after locking the Ya'juj Ma'juj behind a wall, then the entire Ya'juj Ma'juj will remain behind that wall until just before Qiyamah. And with the coming of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, the wall will fall down, the entire world of Ya'juj Ma'juj will come. With such numbers they will come, that Isa alayhi salam and all the Muslims will have to run and they will be destroyed. But if you look at sayings of the pious regarding Ya'juj Ma'juj, you will find Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam on the day of Qiyamah will be told, send the people to Jahannam. So Adam alayhi salam will say, how many? Who is the people of Jahannam? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam will say, every 1,000 in front of you, 999 in Jahannam. And one must go to Jannah. And on that, when that announcement is made, and at that moment everyone will just, because you're standing in a line, who knows who's that one from that 999 who will go to Jannah. So Sahaba radiallahu anhu got extremely worried. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam later called them and smiled to them. And he said, it will be 999 of the Ya'juj Ma'juj in Jahannam, and you will be one in Jahannam. 999 in Jahannam from the Ya'juj Ma'juj, and one from you in Jahannam. In Jahannam. Meaning in the people of Jahannam, that 999 itself, if you take that 999 and you make it 100%, from that 100%, that 99% will go to them. 999 from that now 1,000. And one Arab will go to Jahannam. So that means the Arabs that will be in Jannah will be a very big amount. Because the majority will be Ya'juj Ma'juj in Jahannam. You got this? 999 from the 1,000 people going to Jahannam now, 999 will make up Ya'juj Ma'juj. One will make up, and he spoke to the Arab, so most likely it was the Arab. This hadith shows us that the Ya'juj Ma'juj can't be a small tribe or a big tribe behind one wall that one day will come out and suddenly be destroyed. There'll have to be a tribe right from the beginning of history going down right till the time of Qiyamah, found in every era. A Tabi'i mentioned that the world was divided into 7 parts. One part is you, 6 parts is the Ya'juj Ma'juj. Now who is this Ya'juj Ma'juj? Where are they? So we have to look now for sifat of this Ya'juj Ma'juj. And many people will feel hurt also that how can you call so and so Ya'juj Ma'juj. But remember, Ya'juj Ma'juj is just the name of a progeny. It does not mean you are a Jahannami. If a man from the Ya'juj Ma'juj accepts Islam, he is a Muslim. He accepts Christianity, he becomes a Christian. He accepts the Jewish religion, he becomes a Jew. It is one progeny, like how you have the Arab, how you have a Chinese perhaps, how you have somebody else, you might have one. From the progeny of Yafith, who was the son of Nuh alayhi salam, from his awlad, a tribe called Ya'juj Ma'juj came in the world. They were blessed with certain qualities. One is might, which Dhul-Qarnayn saw. The strength of the Ya'juj Ma'juj was more than other people. The second thing was the love of fasad, where some people have a nature to make more war than other people, whether it's for good purposes or bad purposes. The Turks, when they attacked the entire Muslim world, majority of ulama said they are part of the Ya'juj Ma'juj. Later on, they all accepted Islam. They remained in that same progeny of Ya'juj Ma'juj. And after accepting Islam, they continued with their war. The desire for war was there, ingrained in them. They fought against the Arabs also, they fought against the Muslims, they took over everything and then they served Islam. Dhul-Qarnayn came upon primitive people and he found that they could not speak the language. He left them on their way. Ulama say from there we can take out the tariqah of Ya'juj Ma'juj. That their way is wherever they will find primitive people, they will destroy their primitive way of life and say, you must come onto our way of life or be destroyed. Ya'juj Ma'juj. They love fasad, they love fitna, extra power they got. وَتَرَكْنَا بَعْدَهُمْ يَوْمَ إِذِي يَمُوجِ Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, when they will open up, you will find the Ya'juj Ma'juj, one falling into the other like a wave. A wave, one goes up, the other one pushes it down. And as that one comes down, that same one that pushed it down pushes it up again. The Ya'juj Ma'juj will have that quality that they will kill their own people, destroy their own nations and push them up again. They will make sure they don't get destroyed completely. Russia was destroyed at the hands of Afghanistan. Then the president of Pakistan made an announcement that the Russian army must walk out with disgrace. There and there, America, who was the sole agent responsible for the destruction of Russia, comes into the picture to save Russia from disgrace and says, we cannot allow a decision like this. Russia must be able to come out without anything like this. One helping the other. Now who will be this Ya'juj Ma'juj then? So certain ulama have said perhaps, and this is perhaps, the coming of history will then show the reality. They have targeted it on many nations. One is the Turks. And the Ya'juj Ma'juj, Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's description divided them into three different types of size. How they will look. So it means different nations. So one nation which is practically, if history wants to show who is this Ya'juj Ma'juj who has brought Israel, the Jews out of the world and brought them to Israel, then it is not hard to pick a nation. From the entire Ya'juj Ma'juj nation, one group of them, which brought the Jews from everywhere in the world to one place, it will be a European nation, wherever they scattered in the world. Now the European nation, if you look in the books of history, you will find in the last century, Europe has gone through an amazing, what they will call revolution. From the dark ages, suddenly this world comes up. Europe. So strong that Islam tried to go into Europe many times. But the people of Europe somehow had a power to keep Islam out. Now in Europe, two groups came out. One was that group which accepted Christianity, European Christians you will call them. And one is that group in the 7th century, they accepted the Jewish religion. They will be called European Jews. The European Christians, as soon as they accepted Christianity, they developed such an obsession to liberate the Holy Land that the Crusade started. They were Byzantine Christians, what we will call original Christians, from the tribe of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, who had nothing to do with the Crusades. When these European Christians passed their territory also, they never joined the army. It would have been normally a Christian who would fight for his land. Here it was one who was not an original Christian, who had never been taken out of that land, obsessed that I must get that land back. And when they finally did take over it, they committed such bloodshed in the holy lands of Baytul Muqaddas that many Christians distanced themselves. That this is not what a Christian will ever do in this land. They showed that they are more an animal than man. So at that time, many people wondered, what is this nation? Thereafter, Salahuddin Ayyubi rahimullah came in. After about 90 years, they were removed. Then everything started happening. And this is our history now, which many of us saw, or many of us were born just after, or many of our fathers saw. And this, inshallah, will go very fast. Try and keep up. 1914, the Duke of Austria was assassinated. This is just to put us in a picture of what happened and how it came. So when this Duke of Austria was assassinated, they followed the footsteps to Russia, that the law came from Russia to have him killed. And Russia wasn't intended, but Britain was intended, to bring Britain into a war to destroy its mighty power that it had over the whole world. So Russia was the culprit of killing this Duke, but Britain was brought into the war. So when the war started, Austria made voice that we will wage war against Russia. As soon as that voice was made, Austria against Russia, then Britain and France came into the war. Because Britain's ally was Russia. So Britain had nothing to do with the war. But they were pulled into a war which had nothing to do with them. So Britain and France now on Russia's side. When Britain and France came into the war, Germany came into the war on Austria's side. That if you come on your side, I will come on our side. Germany had nothing to do with the war. When Germany came in the war, the Ottoman Empire, which was the Islamic Khilafat, a Khilafat which from the time of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam remained throughout. There was never a period when it was abolished. This Ottoman Empire was pulled into the war. The Jews are Germany's ally. So come into the war. With the killing of one man, a plan was made to destroy a Khilafat. Where the Muslim Khilafat had nothing to do with that Austrian Duke being killed. Germany was brought into the war. Britain was brought into the war. The purpose of this war was to destroy Britain's power and to destroy the Ottoman Empire. And in what a way it was done? That Britain then was used to destroy the Ottoman Empire. Where Britain had nothing to do with the war, Ottoman Empire had nothing to do with the war. Britain was ordered, you all must destroy the Ottoman Empire. And Britain committed thereafter that treachery with the Arab world, which saw that the Saud government was put in place and the Khilafat of the Turkeys were removed, and then the entire Arab world was divided, and Palestine was brought under British rule. What that Britain destroyed, the Turkish Empire, Britain got destroyed. It was the last time that Britain had political power. After that war, 1914 to 1916, this war continued. In 1916, Britain realized they're losing the war. So then the Jews came to them and said that we will bring the USA into this war if you all promise us the Holy Land of Palestine. And in 1916, a Balfour Declaration took place that we will give you all this land. And now the USA came in as a supreme power. Britain was now dropped. Palestine was given over to the Britain. From 1916 to 1948, the Jews of the world were brought inside to make Israel the center point of Jews of the world. Who brought them inside? A European power. And one of the central powers was Britain. And thereafter it moved over to America. Obviously I can't end this year, and time is up. So inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala, maybe next week or whenever the chance comes, this will have to then continue. That what did Britain get out of bringing them here? What did America then get out of bringing them here? Why are they being brought here? What does the Zionist intend bringing them here? Why is the Jew coming here? And why has Allah tabarak wa ta'ala made this entire big plan that all this must happen before a final decision is passed? So if Allah tabarak wa ta'ala grants us tawfiq, inshallah, in the future, we'll try and mention that. Wa akhiru da'wah.